Well, thank you so much. Good morning to everybody. I'm glad that I got a chance to stand up because when Darren was talking about grantees, we've had a couple of projects that have actually been funded by Ford, and I think StoryCorps being one of them that we were the interaction designers for. And so it's really no surprise that Ford Foundation would be able to lead the charge in presenting data visualization and different organizations and individuals that are doing work in this realm. Because it really is on the forefront of what we're working on today. This is the Sugar Hill Children's Museum of Art and Storytelling, which just got an Art Place grant, which is also a Ford Foundation grantee, so I wanted to thank you for that. The talk that I'm going to be giving today is really about what connects people together. And so it seems like a natural place to sort of launch off with a day like today when you think about it, because technology is obviously a large part of what is bringing people together, one to the next. And it's a real question for us, I think, particularly in this era, and particularly for this audience, when we consider what is it that actually drives people to connect together, to collaborate together, and particularly in constructive ways. Technology, interestingly enough, gets both a lot of praise and then also a lot of skepticism about the ways in which it connects people together. Right, so if you think about things like Google and Facebook and the network topologies that we live within and that we travel within, it's quite obvious that it's making these connections, but you also feel the backlash as typified in things like this, right? Is Google making us stupid? And it was such a big article by The Atlantic that actually brought out a sequel, right? So here's the sequel. Is Facebook making us lonely? So there's a lot of different ways in which we're anxious. They actually have a journalist right now working on his Yelp, making us order really bad Chinese food. Like one by one, we have this sense that even as technology is changing and ramping up and making these new connections possible, there's something being lost, something in the transition itself, something in what I refer to, at least within our work, as the age of discovery, all of these new tools, these new extensions, really, of our own abilities. There's this great quote by McLuhan that I like to use. It's a paraphrase, every extension is also an amputation, just acknowledging the fact that as technology is moving forth, there are things that are going to be lost. And that this actually, even as it arguably is a market-driven process, these new products are being tossed at us and people are adopting them without actually thought, without actually consideration, that we as a collective society and perhaps even the people in particular in this room have a chance to be thoughtful about the way technology is changing us for positive and sometimes in negative ways. And so I wanted to give just three examples of projects of different organizations that are using and adopting technology in very proactive, very constructive ways that are specifically mission-based. That's the important thing about it. So the first project is Lumiere. This is a new project that we're actually just in the midst of working on. But it's so on target with a lot of the groups here, I wanted to share a sort of sneak preview of it. This is for a group called the Jacob Burns Film Center. If you don't know them, they're a not-for-profit that works on film education. They're in Westchester, but they're essentially looking to scale national, and they've brought us in as a partner to think about how technology can do that. So they have a really incredible group of educators and also board. They have both Steven Spielberg and Ron Howard on their board, as well as other filmmakers and different educators. And the thing that I think really gets these folks excited about the next generation in terms of film education, because they've built an education center at their, and they hold classes and they run individual workshops, is really thinking about this, right? That this is actually where most kids are learning about media today. Not this in particular, not YouTube per se, but the sort of great Wild West of media that kids in particular are so incredibly awash in. And the challenge, I think, or one challenge that these folks are trying to face head on is the idea of media literacy, is the idea of how do you actually inject the types of values and interests of the Jacob Burns Film Center into a world like this outside of just the classroom? How do you, you know, scale that large? And so what we've been working on is a project called Lumiere, and it's essentially a platform for learning that we call a viewing and doing platform. So it's essentially a way both to look at media and then to make media. It's very fluid between those two states. And it basically teaches visual literacy through kids actually making stuff. So it has all these different challenges built into it. We call them courses or challenges. It's a platform for educators to collaborate with kids themselves, right? So here are some of the different challenges. And they're very, very small little assignments that kids can use, right? And so They're built on examples of media that kids are interested in. So it's very important to be, you know, up in terms of popular culture itself. And then in terms of the ways that it works, essentially, it starts to look at media both as a collective action. So this is all about different tablets and different desktop applications for kids to collaborate with, but also about this idea that media can be used as building blocks. So when you think about the types of tools that we build for people to manipulate media, typically they're these sort of complicated or semi-complicated editing tools, right? And the tools themselves are arguably agnostic, like everything from iMovie to Final Cut Pro. These are big software packages that kids don't necessarily have access to, right? But in the same way that in kindergarten you're learning to both read and write, Jacob Burns is interested in that for media. That you shouldn't have to be a sixth grader or ninth grader or an editing professional to actually make media. There should be tools for kids to understand that in constructive ways. So this is just like a little mock-up, what we call wireframes. And essentially, this is the way the interface would work. It would have all these different little chunks of media, and you'd be able to swipe just to draw connections between them. So it's a very, very simple, elegant way to get kids to think about media and how it's actually constructed. And then once you actually construct, then you can deconstruct. Then you can actually look at the media and understand it, that it's a fabricated world, right? And this is really, I think, the next generation. When you think about broadcast media, there wasn't the opportunity to do this. But with something like Lumiere, you can essentially take pre-existing clips like this and start to actually connect them together, one to the next, and show them as an actual linear sequence itself. So it's a very simple way to think about making a collaborative tool for kids to actually make media together. So that's just on the drawing boards. But the next thing I want to talk about in terms of connecting is Change by Us. And Change by Us, I think, is a good example of the way in which an organization can have a sort of hunch that technology could play a constructive role, but not actually know what that role would be. So we got a call from Carol Coletta, who now runs Art Place, but at the time was running CEOs for Cities. And she said to us, you know, you all did StoryCorps, and you're working with the 9/11 Memorial. You have the sense of how people talk to each other. Do you think you could take some of those skills and apply it to a city, right? Because cities have a sort of big challenge in that they have all these people who do have shared, oftentimes, interests and oftentimes values and physical space and tools, but they don't have a good way to actually talk to each other. And so we took on the challenge to look at building a participation project for an entire city. And so the first thing that we did was do some research in terms of how cities talk to each other. And we just put a community meeting into Flickr, right? And these are just example photos that we grabbed. And so typically, you know, the powers that be start to talk, and you have people who are listening, right? And then someone gets up at asks a sort of pointed question, and then, you know, whoever is presenting sort of gets hot under the collar, and it's a really awkward moment. And then this person in the back yells, and then he yells at him. And this person is like getting a headache because everyone's yelling at each other, and this person has a point, and this person wants to say something, and then they go back and forth and back and forth, right? And then this lady shows up. Right, and like this is always the way that it works. And the amazing thing about this is that actually this whole process was an innovation, an incredible innovation 100 years ago. The idea of actually engaging the public was just totally radical at the turn of the 19th to the 20th century. But 100 years later, I don't think there's really anybody who would argue this is a particularly efficient or effective way for people to actually collaborate together. And so Change by Us is really a new platform that's looking at some of the more contemporary tools in terms of crowdsourcing, in terms of using technology for people to collaborate together, and applying it to a city itself. So this is an early inspiration film where we're thinking just about people essentially having ideas on how to make a constructive difference in terms of their cities and applying them to all these different spots in terms of your city itself. We got a grant through Rockefeller and through the Knight Foundation and launched a version of Change by Us in New York City for the last Earth Day. So here's Mayor Bloomberg doing the announcement. And it was really exciting to see it in the context of Plan NYC 2012. So the plan, one thing that's interesting about this, or actually two things that I think. One is that the city, how many people here actually know about Plan NYC 2012? Sorry, raise hand. Oh, so this is actually that's a relatively saturated market for this plan. It did not actually, not surprisingly, make a ton of news. There was almost no coverage of it. It was very challenging for the Bloomberg administration to actually get people to pay attention to it. And the reason is because the goals are these types of things, right? And this is what the plan itself looked like. It's hard to get people excited about this, even as this has dramatic, incredible impact on the quality of life within New York City. Now, one thing that's interesting about Change by Us, and one of the reasons the Bloomberg administration partnered with us, is when you actually look at these goals, a lot of these things are very clearly things that only government can do. Right? These are infrastructure problems, transportation problems. These are large sort of top-down oversight problems. Right? But this one, solid waste, this is actually not something that government is even capable of accomplishing. Right? This goal of essentially composting 75% of waste is not anything that the government can mandate or that they could necessarily do. Even Mr. Bloomberg, in his incredible wisdom, recognized the fact that there were limits to the sort of authority of the government. And so Change by Us is actually this move on behalf of this large organization, the government in this case, to actually try to use groups of people, the sort of bottom up, the sort of grassroots, if you will, and inspire them to actually become involved in sustainability and to accomplish that goal in particular of composting. So this is Change by Us. It's a web and a mobile platform. And essentially, you put in an idea, and then you locate that idea to a neighborhood. And then the key is it has an algorithm that connects your idea with existing projects. So it's a very simple matching algorithm. And essentially, it's a platform for community-based organizations, small groups, yes, not-for-profits as well, to essentially promote themselves to a larger audience and then to match themselves with different people who are interested in what they're doing. And one thing that's interesting also is the way that this essentially matches the way in which people communicate about the types of things that they're doing. And it brings forth an amplification from an institutional level, right? So from a very, very small investment, there were mini grants that essentially motivated people to put their platform, their projects onto the platform. Right, so from these very small lift in terms of the mini grants, you get this incredible amplification through the number of hours of service and the number of volunteers themselves. And this is just the overall effect of the project itself in its first year. And then when you actually look at the actual effect themselves, right, you see that this is actually what change starts to look like. It's the platform that's actually powering these different groups to work together on things like community gardens, and on things like this, on street fairs. And so what's interesting, I think, also is going back to the government's interest in promoting Plan NYC 2012, you know, our hunch is essentially that these types of things, whether it's street fairs or social media, is really actually about how the word will get out about sustainability in cities. It's no longer this sort of top-down message. It's really about each of these individuals taking action, passing it person to person, and having a system that can then amplify that into an exponentially greater and larger audience. So in terms of my favorite projects, I always like to share this. This is Brook Park Chickens. This is in the South Bronx. And so the mini grants went to all these different organizations that applied. And they applied for $700 to purchase chickens so that they could raise them in the South Bronx. The chickens, hilariously enough, live this incredibly idyllic lifestyle, right? This looks like Martha Stewart or something. They're like hanging out. But this is actually what the project is like. Essentially, it's teaching kids where food comes from, developing ideas about social justice and food practices right within the actual neighborhood itself. Not surprisingly, this got about literally 10 times as much press as Plan NYC 2012. Because it's an incredible story, right? These chickens are living in the South Bronx. And the city, honestly, doesn't want to get into the chicken business, right? But what they do want to get into is a sustainability business, and they can use this project to help promote those types of ideas. And this is actually the effect that it has, right, on people's actual lives. You can just imagine. So the last project I'm going to share is our work with the 9/11 Memorial Museum. And so this is an engagement that we've been involved with for over 7 years at this point. We were part of the original team that won the exhibition design and master plan for the institution. Then we got involved with the memorial itself. So the memorial opened last year on the anniversary, and then the museum's going to open next year. And so I'll talk about the work on a memorial first. So the memorial itself, designed by Michael Arad, had this very interesting idea in terms of how the names were actually going to be arranged on the memorial. And the idea was that they wouldn't be done chronologically or alphabetically. They would essentially be done through what are called meaningful adjacencies. And so we partnered with Jared Thorpe, who's here today, on an algorithm that helped to do that arrangement. And essentially what happened was the foundation reached out to the almost 3,000 victims next of kin and created a database of all these different connections between the different names themselves. And within those connections, you can see these green lines here, are these personal relationships between the different names themselves. And so you had a way in which you could understand the names through the actual personal relationships embedded within the arrangement itself. So this is a piece of software we built, the memorial guide that essentially explains the overall structure, and this is both on the web and then it's also on site and also mobile. And essentially what you're looking at is the ability to search by any individual group, and it'll actually show you specifically on the memorial where that group is located and the individual names themselves. But more importantly, you can actually see those individual relationships. So this is a good example of a family of three who don't share the same last name, who are clustered together in one area within the memorial. And then these are two brothers, one a firefighter and one a police officer, also clustered directly next to each other, one next to the other. And you get this incredible sense of the relationships themselves and really of the stories that are embedded within those names, some of which the general public will know and some of which they'll find out through a mobile app. So this actually has all the relationships and then it has individual stories built into it. And from the museum side, we were involved early on in a project that essentially gathered stories about 9/11 from all around the world. And so it takes images like this of Street View and actually overlays images of the past onto it. So you get this incredible double vision between the past and the present itself. And between these types of images that we gathered, we also gathered stories of people and what they did on that day. So this is really the simplest story booth that we've ever created. And you go into the booth and just locate yourself on the map and tell your story. It's in six different languages. And from there, we started this collecting process and really started to understand that the museum would be almost like a platform, a place for people to share their different stories one to the next. And so in a number of ways, we revolutionary, the first of which is the first voice that you hear when you enter into the museum is essentially a voice like your own. So I'm going to play a quick clip from some of those stories, but it's essentially an audio collage of everybody's 9/11 story.
I was in Korea.
I was in Kiev, Ukraine.
University in Paris.
I was at Rutgers in New Brunswick.
And they said that the
there's a fire
one of the World Trade Towers just
exploded.
From there, you go into a number of different galleries that have these different collages of media, which are donated and which are collected together into these archives, which are essentially collected but are telling, again, the story of 9/11. So these are different faces of different witnesses from that day. Right, and it has this way of essentially matching all the different people together. So you get the sense of this collective witness. There's not a curator telling you about the millions and arguably billions of people who are watching the event live at that moment. But you get a sense of it from the way the media is actually portrayed. These are different shots from all around the city. And so we didn't want to actually say all of New York gathered on its rooftops to watch this event. You can essentially signal that through the data itself, through the actual photographs and overlaying them one on top of the other and getting a sense of all these different view sheds. I think embedding stories into the actual ways that you tell those stories is really the critical aspect. And so just to show a couple other pieces that we got from the website that are going to be part of the exhibition, this is a part of Flight 11, obviously, that someone was just snapping as they ran out of the buildings themselves. This is an interesting shot where we discussed this in meetings. This is a shot of the towers from a commercial flight that was being grounded at LaGuardia. We always said, you know, if we could only find that photo, but of course, once we made this project, the photo came to us. And that's a lot of the shapes of these types of projects, is building a platform for communication with your audience and then actually capitalizing on those types of relationships. This is interesting where this fire truck is going to be in the final museum. We had shots of it on the site, and we also have the artifact itself, but we didn't have shots of it until on Staten Island until this New Jersey National Guard soldier just uploaded it amongst literally dozens of other photos that he had. And then this is the last photo I'll show. I saw this photo when we actually launched the project just because it was so dramatic and I think really tells such a powerful story about 9/11. If you know the site, this is actually the Brooklyn Battery Tunnel, right? So you're seeing a car that's obviously going towards Brooklyn trying to get out of Manhattan. And then you're seeing a fire truck that's stuck in traffic, and you're seeing these firemen who are running. If you know the distance, that's a good 2 miles from the site, right, with this heavy equipment. What's amazing is, so this fellow Eric Trollson, who I believe is from Norway, uploaded it. And a couple of days later, we got an email just to the regular project email asking to get in touch with him. And the person who wrote it said, you know, it's hard to describe what this photo means to me. I was looking through the literally thousands of photos on your site, and I found this photo, which is of my son. And as I understand, it's the last photo that was ever taken of him alive. And so there's this incredible moment of understanding that when you build these platforms, you have these opportunities to make these types of connections, to foster these types of relationships, and that technology itself is really just the conduit to the type of agency that all of us are trying to express. So in the same ways that people have been writing books to express ideas or making films or sharing one to the other or developing programs to foster different talents, I think that's really the types of connections that we have an opportunity to make with technology. Between the group that we have here and all the different presenters, you'll get a sense of the different opportunities that we all share. But it really is, again, about sort of centering yourself on the mission of your organization and really on the types of changes that you want to see made. And with that, I will say thank you so much.
Wow, powerful stuff. Thank you so much, Jake, for the work you're doing and for this introduction to the art of what's possible. You're all going to have an opportunity to speak with Jake this afternoon during the workshops. But before we let you go right now, this was just a little taste. You'll have more later. Before we let you go, I wanted to put one question to you that I think is going to be a driving question for us throughout the day. And that is, Darren said this morning that our aim is to offer inspiration, knowledge, and confidence. And you certainly got us going on the inspiration part of that. But I hope you can offer some confidence, too. The question is it realistic for the folks in this room whose expertise and excellence lies in areas very different from your own, is it realistic for us to aspire in the direction of these incredible examples you've given in our work?
Yeah, I think, I mean, I've been really heartened by the different ways in which institutions, both large and small, and both contemporary as well as very traditional, have been able to harness media for really positive, constructive change. I think in our experience, it really comes from a couple things. It comes from a good mixture of a CEO or sort of governing body that has the sense that this is important, that understands and acknowledges that these shifts are coming, whether we like them or not, and that the shifts will impose changes on organizations, whether they like it or not. So one thing is just sort of an acknowledgement of the reality of this giant shift. And within that, the capacity to embrace that in a positive or constructive way, I think, is key. And then also having the ability to both let go and say, we're going to trust either a sort of in-house lab or an out-of-house consultant or a group of different workshops to help brainstorm about these ideas, but then also to, again, retain the expertise that the organization has. So we're working for the Cleveland Museum of Art, and they never said to us, go ahead and reinvent our museum, you know, without our involvement. They said, you guys are the technology experts, and you're going to come in and think about visitor experience. And I assured them that we actually wanted to base the new experience through technology on the existing art museum experience. And they trusted us, and through an iterative prototyping process, we've come to something that looks very much like what they're doing now, but really extended in all these different exciting ways. So that's one sort of blueprint, I think, for a process, where you'll have someone from the top really saying, this is coming, whether we like it or not. It can be a big opportunity for us. And then engaging in a series of different experiments and really evaluating them through the core mission to think if they actually embody that core mission.
Great. Thank you so much for that. And so much more to come later on from Jake. Good morning again. I'm Alfred Ironside. I'm the Director of Communications here at the Ford Foundation. And I hope you'll join me in thanking Jake one more time for the inspiration he offered and also the confidence, the vote of confidence he just gave us.